My name's Kelly. I am an interviewer here at WMAP Radio. You can find us on WMAPradio.com. And if you want to come on our show, you can go to that website and book yourself. We'd love to hear from you. We interview all different types of people, from authors to life coaches to real estate people to doctors. And everyone's got their own way about them and what they're doing. And we get to hear about it and interview them all day.
Kelly Cacho, and you'll hear her every day, 2 to 6 on WMAPradio.com. Also, 103.9. LI News Radio. I got the eye of the tiger, the fire, dancing through the fire, cause I am the champion, and you're gonna hear me roar louder, louder than a lion, cause I am the champion, and you're gonna hear me roar.
All right, guys. Hey, it's Kelly. I'm back with you today. We had some really great interviews yesterday, so I hope everyone was listening, and we have some great ones lined up for you today. The first one to start out the day is a woman who I've really, really been enjoying talking to, and I know you guys have been enjoying getting to hear her, so I'm really excited to have her back on the show today. We have Marcy Stone, who is the author of The Voice of an Angel, A Mother's Guide to Grief and How to Thrive After the Loss of a Child, and she's also a life coach, and among other things, she does so many things. So let's introduce her to the show. Hey, Marcy, how are you doing?
Hi, Kelly. That was like the nicest intro ever. Thank you.
Oh, no problem. It's all true. You know,
wow.
Everything is true. And I really love talking to you and having you on the show. I think you're really just a great fit with our station and what we do. And we just always enjoy having you on. So it's always a pleasure.
Thanks.
No problem. All right. So I know that, you know, you went on vacation and I want to ask you a million questions about it. But maybe just tell us real quick. Did you have a great time on your trip?
We had a fabulous time. We went to Cancun. It was a little bit of a last-minute escape. Not sure if we were doing it for our anniversary or for birthdays, but it just turned out to be fabulous. 85 degrees, no humidity, no bugs. The sand is so beautifully, like, clear. It was fabulous. Yeah, it was really hard getting back on the plane to come home to 38 degrees. Rainy. But, you know, you got to do what you got to do.
Yeah, no, of course. Well, we're glad to have you back, but I can understand because I would not want to leave either, especially it's getting really cold, and I believe we're expecting a little bit of snow tomorrow, but
don't say that out loud.
Yes, that's true. That was a bad idea. All right, so let's get into today a little bit, and I know we've been able to talk about the book, and we've been able to talk about what you do in your profession as a life coach, but today I wanted to talk about the topic of motherhood, because especially, you know, that, you know, motherhood is so a part of your book as well. And you've just had a really amazing journey into motherhood. And I wanted to start kind of all the way back at the beginning. Now, you know, a lot of women, when we're young, you know, we see mothers, we have mothers. And a lot of times, you know, growing up, we have baby dolls and we think, yes, I can't wait to be a mom. What were your feelings on that growing up?
Absolutely none of those things. None of them. I played with trucks. We blew up Barbie dolls in the sandbox. I found crawfish and brought them home. My mom always made me take them back. I was always about freedom and being a kid. I had never even dawned on me that I might someday be a mom. It was nowhere in my future, my vision, nothing.
Yeah, and you know what? You're not the only one that I've spoken to that's felt that way. You know, I have a girlfriend of mine, and that's how she's always been. She just never wanted to go that route, and I don't know if she ever will, you know. And I think that's a great view to have, but I know somewhere along the line that can change. And I know you went through some pretty serious things at 16. You had laser surgeries for cervical cancer. What was that like, hearing that word cancer at such a young age?
Well, I think there's a beauty to hearing it at that age because it doesn't really ring serious.
Mm-hmm.
It really didn't. It was, they called it dysplasia, early stage, not a big deal, you know, all of the keeping it down on the down low. And so I just went back repeatedly and having these little, they called them laser surgeries. They were basically shelling away the cells. And so I went through that.
That, yeah.
Well, I was 27.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. But that's a lot though. But I guess you're right. At a young age, you know, we don't think of everything that's involved. It's like a beauty of not knowing really what's
right.
involved
with
cancer. Yeah, of course. At that age, you're definitely invincible. Now, what age did they tell you that you were not able to have children?
I was probably 20, 21. I was in the beginnings of a pretty serious relationship, my husband. And I want to tell you, I think both of us were probably pretty happy about that. You know, we both were just looking to have fun, have a good time. Mm-hmm. I was very immature. Again, freedom and fun was all he was thinking about. And he was not too disappointed with that. And that was it. And we just did that, freedom and fun. Had a grand old time. Never talked about getting married. Never talked about being serious. Nothing. Just having fun.
And then you get that surprise news that, oh my gosh, you are pregnant. And I know that must have, because you were in that mindset of, I'm not going to have kids and I can't have kids, so I'm going to live life this way. What were those emotions like? I can imagine for me, I would have been in a tailspin.
Yeah, right. Today I define it as a meltdown. because I saw a flashback. My first response was, that can't be right. Go back and check the test again. You had to have made a mistake. This is just not possible.
Yeah.
When they came back, like, no, it's really, really real. I'm like, oh, crap. I remember going home, and I was afraid to tell him, like, what am I going to say? How am I going to say this? Because he's going to say, well, I thought you told me, you know. And he wasn't that bad. He wasn't, like, yelling at me, but he wasn't exactly, he's like, well, okay.
Yeah.
This is where we are. And I really, when I look back at it, I'm very disappointed in myself. Again, I was very immature, in my defense, because, you know, I believe that a child from first conception can feel your emotions, feel your energy. So I really tried to make up for that through the pregnancy at that moment in time.
Yeah. And I still believe, I mean, is that something you still believe today, that right when you are pregnant, that child can feel everything that's going on?
I absolutely do.
Yeah, I do too. I really think that is something for sure. So,
and, you know, when you as a mom can feel them, how can they not feel you?
That's very true. And, you know, I had gone through a pregnancy. It didn't work out, unfortunately. But I, you know, it was, even at that early stage, you can really feel it. You know, you really feel what's going on. And you have this barrage of hormones and emotions over you. And the way I thought was that there is no way that this baby has no idea what's going on with me. I really felt that connection.
It's super cool, isn't it?
It's very cool. Definitely. It's a very,
very
cool.
And I'm so sorry, by the way. So sorry.
That's okay. You know, it was something that happened, and I've, you know, I was able to move forward. And, you know, I'm in that stage where I hope one day, you know, that it will happen again. And if it doesn't, I'll be okay with that too. So now, not only were you pregnant, but you were pregnant with twins. So that must have been an even bigger shock.
It was. It was definitely a shock. My ex-husband was a twin. Never, and he had a very similar experience. His twin didn't make it either. So no one on his side of the family was surprised by it. We didn't find out until probably midway through the pregnancy that we did, in fact, have twins. Mm-hmm. And that's because I think Aubrey's sibling wasn't doing well.
Yeah.
And so it was monitored throughout. And I would say probably about 7.5 months is when they started to say, you know, and they were saying he wasn't going to make it. And it was a lot. It happened in such a quick span of weeks that, you know, it wasn't even like we had time to wrap our head around the fact that it was happening before we had to wrap our head around our head that it wasn't happening. It was just so surreal. It really was. And then they were telling us that, and I look back at it now, hindsight, I understand why they were telling me this, that Aubrey wasn't going to make it. She had issues that they told me she had a hole in her heart, spinal bifida, wow. And everything they were doing. We even did an amnio. That's where they stick the needle down through your belly. That was awful. I don't recommend it.
No, sure.
But they couldn't show me. They were taking level 4 ultrasounds. They couldn't show me the spine. They couldn't show me the hole in the heart. All they were telling me is, but there's something wrong. We think you should abort the pregnancy. And I'm like, absolutely not. Not happening.
No, when you're caring for that long already, that's a really tough decision to make.
Yeah, absolutely. There's just no way. I'm like, there's nothing wrong with this child. She's perfectly healthy. You guys are crazy. And sure enough, she was perfectly healthy.
That's such a blessing. I had interviewed a woman on my other show that I do, and she was pregnant with twins. and they knew that there were all these problems. But when she, you know, she was able to have the, the twins, and within a matter of hours, they didn't make it. And I know for her that it was one of the hardest things that she had ever, she was able to hold the babies and they were alive and breathing. And she knew while she was holding them that they weren't going to make it. So as soon as you welcome this baby, you have to, make your goodbyes as well.
Wow.
Not to bring a real, down kind of feeling to the show. But I just think it's important to share another experience with this because, not that it's exactly like what you went through, but just, losing a child in any regard, in any way, even if you haven't met them yet, I'm sure that must have been very difficult.
I have to be honest, and maybe this is my age at the time. I was 23. Maybe at the time, I was just so focused on whether or not I was going to be able to keep Aubrey. They didn't let me hold her right away. They scooped her off and went and do all these crazy tests to make sure she was okay, that I didn't really give it a second thought for a period of time. And so I put all of my energy into Aubrey. It just didn't, I don't know, maybe that's selfish, I'm not sure, but I couldn't focus on that other thing and the what was. I didn't have a time to even adapt to being a mother of two in my own mind, so.
Yeah, and you mentioned that it's selfish, and I don't think that's selfish at all. I actually think it's almost a survival mode for mother and child, yes, of course, this awful thing happened, but of course you would want to put all of your energy into this baby that you still have. I think that's actually a very strong way of dealing with it, and I think that's sometimes better than, what if you put all of these negative feelings into the other one and it caused problems for the other one? I think it's a great
right.
way to deal with it. Now,
well, I'll take that. Thank you.
You're welcome. Now, I know you mentioned that they said Aubrey might have had spinal bifida. And for our listeners that don't know, I don't know how much information you know on it, but maybe you could tell us a little bit about that because I know it's very serious.
Right. Spinal bifida could be something as simple as a curvature of the spine to having the spine completely curved, bent from whatever direction, angle, might not be completely formed. So they might not stand. They might not sit. They might not be able to hold themselves up, to any degree. And to the degree that they were saying it, when they're mentioning to abort, that to me meant they were saying it was something pretty significant from the numbers. If you think about it, though, the numbers were because of the twin.
Yeah.
In the amnio fluid. But, that's hindsight now.
Of course.
But, yes, so spinal bifida could be a pretty... And, I was trying to think of it from the child's perspective, coming into the world like that. But there's a reason for everything, right? As much as I, of all people, hate to say that expression, I do believe there is a reason for everything.
No, and I 100% agree with you. I firmly believe in that. And it's funny that you said that because I hate to admit it sometimes, too, because I feel like I sound crazy. But I do. I think there is a reason for everything. And I think things happen a certain way to make us stronger and to give us these tools to, continue to thrive and to be able to handle other situations.
Right. I agree. Universal test.
Yes, exactly. And all right, so Aubrey, she came out. The doctors took her away. You didn't get to hold her right away. Oh, I would have been feeling crazy about that. But it turns out she was perfect.
I called her my angel baby. Perfect in every regard. Never got sick. Healthy as a horse. Just everything about her was picture perfect. And still is. I'm biased. She's my baby. it was amazing to me. It was a fabulous way to come into parenting, never having even ever held a child before, never held a baby before, Aubrey. They had to show me in the hospital how to hold her.
Yeah.
Somebody said, hold her like a football. I'm like, I don't play football. so she really, really, really made learning how to parent super easy. She really did. She was fabulous, still is fabulous.
That's amazing. And it's, I love, I feel like that analogy with football is a lot of times used for a child. I know when I was born, my father told my mother, he's like, she spun out like a little football. So I guess they just think of babies like football. You hold them like a football. They come out like a football.
Right.
It's a very, it's a great way to describe it.
Every time you and I have spoken, somehow sports analogies have been involved, which I find amazing because I don't know anything about sports. It's just too funny.
Yeah, no, I don't either. Very little. And it is very funny that we have these sports analogies, but they're always so fitting. So how can we not use them, right?
Right, exactly.
All right.
Broaden the audience.
Yes, exactly. So you have this beautiful, perfect baby named Aubrey, your first daughter, and, you know, I'm sure you were over the moon about it. And then you have this these cancerous cells that they return. What did they tell you when they came back, and what were your feelings on that?
They prepared me for it. So the doctor told me once they conditioned me and, you know, picked me back up again off the floor, telling me that I was pregnant, they said, because that was my first question, well, what about all of this that's going on with me? And they said, the body takes over. So the healthy body, which is the womb that protects the baby, mm-hmm. took over the rest of my body. Absolutely amazing technology. Super amazing. And so the cancer stopped. There was no room. The womb took over. Everything that that baby needed was 100%, I say perfect, but what do I know? So then when your body takes over again, and there's, you're not supporting another being, the old standard comes back in. I don't know what else to say. And it comes back in. So I really was ready for it. They told me to be prepared. It might come back, and it did, and we went through that whole thing again. And then when I found out I was pregnant with Sydney, it, sure enough, it stopped again, and, you know, went through. Sydney was way easier.
Yeah.
Pregnancy-wise.
You know, it's so weird. I'm not really a religious person. I have faith, and I have a certain way of believing. But it's really incredible to think of how our bodies work, and that the fact that when you're pregnant, like, cancer puts itself on hold, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And
it's remarkable.
Yeah, it's really, and I honestly didn't know that that was something that happened. I didn't know that was something that could even happen.
I didn't either until they told me, and I'm like, all right, well, you guys seem to know what you're talking about, and it absolutely was the case. Really pretty amazing. And human body is just an incredible vessel.
It definitely is. And after the birth of Sid, did it come back? Were there more issues, or was everything kind of contained?
No, it came back, and I did that. So I had Sydney when I was 95, and we went back through the testing and all the different surgeries, and finally it 27, I had a hysterectomy. It just wasn't prudent anymore. They were telling me that I could continue to have these concerns, and or I could take care of it and then be sure that I was going to be here for the rest of my life with my kids. I'm like, well, that's all you had to say. Let's do it.
Yep, easy decision.
And it was the best decision I ever made, absolutely. It truly was, because there was no fear. It was just done. It was out of the picture, and we just moved on.
Now, something had happened when Aubrey was 3, and I think that for a lot of mothers, it takes, you know, some kind of event where we really come into, well, I don't know if I'm going to say we because I'm not a mother, but where, you know, women really come into that mm-hmm. role of motherhood. Can you tell us a little bit about what happened with Aubrey when she fell?
Sure. She's going to love this. So it was the defining moment for me from going from being... And I don't mean to say it this way, but yet I mean to say it this way. Just a mom to becoming a mama bear. Mm-hmm. And that phrase for me means so much. And Aubrey, at the age of, I'm going to say it was 3. She might have been just shy of 3. She fell down halfway down the steps. I'm not a bad mom, I swear. She, you know, just tripped, mm-hmm. fell on the, and hit the siding of the wall just in the right way that she hit her head, and she cracked her head a little bit. She had 12 stitches. So I remember her starting to cry, and I just went over, and I'm not a drama, just kicking the gear. My dad used to stitch me up with fishing lines, so it was like not a big, just scooped her up with a towel, and we had a house full of people, and I said, okay, Aubrey and I are going to go for a little ride. So we conveniently lived like 5 minutes from the emergency room, and I took her in. They took one look at her, sent her right back to the back and prepped her, and I just told her to keep looking at me, watch my eyes, see how calm. I didn't use those words, but the energy of it, the exchange. She didn't cry at all during the stitches. The doctor was floored. He's like, I've never had that happen before. And it was at that moment that I realized, wow, I have this incredible, and I'm going to use the word power just to make the point, because it's not that you use that power. It's honoring that power over this little being. She has that much trust and that much faith in the fact that she knows she's feeling something, but mom says it's okay, so I'm good. I'm golden. That is an incredible power to have with another human being. And it was at that moment that I realized what my role, what I was really doing with this little person. And it was really life-changing for me.
Yeah, because
it's remarkable.
Of course, because you know, especially when they're really little babies, you know, you're nurturing them and taking care of them, and something I feel like happens when they turn 3, especially they're talking more and you have that different communication with them. So I'm sure that added to it as well, but just in that situation, being able to really come into that role of not just being a mother, not just being the person that carried this child, but being this person's, you're her everything, you're her world.
Absolutely.
Wow.
And I tease, and I say that, you know, Aubrey is hardwired like me, that she's incredibly independent, and she always was. And I always tease, and I still do, and I mean it with absolute most love, and she knows it. She allowed me to parent. I think she humored me. Mm-hmm. You know, even at the age of 2, I didn't potty train her. I told her, you know, hey, honey, because I showed her the book, we're going to go, we're going to potty train. Okay, that was it. It was done. She sat up on the potty. So she did, and I'm like, oh, okay. That was super easy. So it's like, so when I say she humored me, she let me go through the steps and she's like, just played along with me. At this time though, when she turned 3, was an opportunity that she needed me.
Yeah.
And so she needed me, and she also schooled me on how to be a mama bear. It was really remarkable.
And there's 3 things that you listed that really, they really stuck with me. You wrote, be brave, but feel. Be strong, but know your limits. And trust your instincts. And I think those are such powerful words of wisdom for anybody, but especially for someone who's a mother, because we have to know where we can come in and what we can do, but also not overpower the situation and let our children learn and really come into their own. And I just wanted to comment on that because I think those are so true. And I think they're just some of the best advice you can give to anyone who's becoming a mother or just caring for someone in general.
I think it's super important that as a mother or a mama bear, you live those because your children emulate your every move. They're watching. They're hiding up top of the steps, listening to conversations. They're not missing anything. So if they see you doing this, you're living by example. Mm-hmm. And then you're helping this little being become the best little being they can be at every age. It's really, again, it's the difference between being a mom and maybe just going through the motions versus being a mama bear and being completely 100% engaged and conscious throughout the whole thing. Because you can very easily check out.
Oh, of course. And, you know, we've seen it in countless stories. And I'm sure we all know someone who maybe was not able to handle it and did check out, you know, maybe not fully, but there are times when that does happen. And you really went through something pretty serious. You know, you went through a divorce, and that really changes a lot. And a lot of times that can be the checkout time, but that didn't happen for you. When you went through the divorce, what changed as far as your relationship with your daughters and that role? What kind of changed after that?
So I will be honest, I did check out. Mm-hmm. And it was the divorce that woke me back up again. I felt I was falling into this, you know, when you're unhappy and you don't know where you're going and you're just riding the wave and you're trying to make it to the next day. So when the divorce happened, it was resetting the clock. It was, everything was brand new. We had a new lease on life, and I absolutely felt that way. And it changed the girls and I. It changed the way we communicated. It just brought me back to this place. It was like recentering for me. And they saw it. They made comments, wow, you know, this is a different mama. It was terrific, but I didn't feel like I needed to fight anything. I could just be me and just be what I needed and who I wanted to be. And the girls truly benefited from that completely.
Yes, I'm sure they did. And what, as far as, you know, what you guys did together, I know you guys formed a little team. You know, it wasn't just, I'm the mother, these are my daughters. You guys were really a team. What were those dynamics like?
So we referred to ourselves as we three in everything. When you look at our pictures, it's me in the middle of the 2 girls. It's just the cool. And every time we go someplace, it's just really, really fabulous. It wasn't like we even planned it that way. It always happened that way. And we found ways because we were always together. So it was we three. And I wouldn't have had it any other way. It wasn't like, you know, the usual every other weekend kind of arrangement. It was we three. And I wanted them to know that I wasn't the boss. that we were going to do this parenting thing together. So we created this thing around the table. It was a round table because we had a round table. And it was the opportunity that every weekend, and if they needed to call an extra meeting, they let me know. But they were allowed to say anything they needed. If they were angry at me, or if they were, if something bad happened at school, or they, you know, Mom, you're embarrassing me when you hug me, when you drop me off at school, something like that. They were allowed to say whatever they wanted to say, and all emotions had to be accepted. I couldn't get upset with them if they swore, because that was the opportunity that they were allowed to. Now, that wasn't like an everyday thing. The swearing stopped after the round table. But there was a time where we created a, I didn't know what to do. We tried going to counselors after divorce. They were having no parts of that. Mm-hmm. No parts of that. So we created a wall out in the garage that they were allowed to get all of their emotions out on the wall. Who doesn't, what kid doesn't want to paint a wall in their house, right?
Yeah,
they did
course.
This up until when I sold that house, it took like 4 or 5 coats of Kills paint to cover that up. But the deal was, for every negative emotion, every negative word, every negative feeling, they had to also then paint something positive. So it was bringing them back to, if you're really upset about this, what can you either do to make it better, or what else are you happy about? And it was a really, really great way to understand what they were feeling, so I had a better understanding of what was going on in their head, or why they were doing certain things, or why they were acting the way they were acting. It was a remarkable parenting tool that, in all honesty, when I started doing it, that was not why. It just was a beautiful accident. From it, I was just really doing it so they had a place to release, because the counselor just wasn't working. They would go to the counselor and they would sit for an hour in silence.
Yeah, and it seems
like that's,
oh, sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
I was going to say, it seems to me that, you know, and the root of all of this, of everything you've done, is communication. And I think a lot of that gets lost sometimes. A lot of parents feel, well, I'm the parent and that's my role, but you gave your children that outlet to communicate with you, to express their feelings freely without anything, you know, without consequence, to really tell them how you were feeling. And that is what's so important with any relationship, whether it's parent to child, husband to wife, wife to wife, husband, you know, whatever relationship, communication is so important. And to be able to express it freely and to really share how you're feeling and, you know, put it into words in a way where you don't have to feel fear of doing that. I think it's so important. And the fact that you've done that, and in such an incredible way, you really gave them this great outlet. I believe that's why your system works so well.
Oh, thank you for that. I really appreciate it. Unconditional communication is something that cannot be taken for granted. Absolutely. And another thing that goes with unconditional communication is you, as a parent, have to communicate I let them know when I made a mistake, or if I did something wrong, or if I'm having a bad day, or, you know what, when I was a kid, this is how I handled it, and I wish I would have done it differently, in life examples versus just, no, you can't do that.
Yeah.
And it made it, they saw me as a person, not just as this overbearing mom. And they would say, hey, Mom, you just messed that all up. I'm like, yep, you know what? You're right, 100%. I absolutely screwed that up. Now how am I going to fix that? And they would come up with ways of helping me fix it versus me always coming up with stuff. It was remarkable to watch their brains, how smart they were at such a young age and what they were capable of doing. And, you know, the idea of understanding the concept of a core value, might not call it that, but, you know, they're listening. They understand. So we came up with all the core values that we would live by, you know, how to have a happy household. And unconditional communication was the number one for us at that time. And Mom admitting when she's wrong was, like, thing number 6. So I must have struggled with that early in my parenting days. But now I have no problems admitting when I'm wrong. I do it all the time.
No, that's
but,
cool.
Yeah, communication in every relationship, peer-to-peer, mother-daughter, I mean, it's just remarkable what can do to a relationship.
Now, I want to give our listeners the name of your book again, which is The Voice of an Angel, A Mother's Guide to Grief and How to Thrive After the Loss of a Child. And now, you know, you had went through that. Unfortunately, you know, your daughter, Sid, you know, was taken. And I know you still are able to communicate with her, which is so amazing. But I wanted to ask, you know, I know a lot had to change afterwards. But as far as your relationship with Aubrey, what came after, you know, how was that relationship between you guys after that happened?
it feels stronger because I'm watching Aubrey. How do I say this without? Aubrey is such a peaceful soul, and she's very happy to be in a group, just wants to be there, wants to be a part of it. Sydney was she was a huge presence. As soon as you walked in the room, you just felt her. You knew she was there. She was not loud, but she had a voice. You heard her. And she was very opinionated, and she liked, and she was super smart. She was way ahead of all of us from a logic, intuitive kind of perspective. So we very easily just kind of let her rule the roost. Yeah, okay, you do what you need. That's cool. We just were happy. She was the comic of the group. We just laughed at all her jokes. I mean, we didn't even try to be funny because it was so much fun watching her be funny, if that makes sense.
Yeah, no, that totally makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, she just, and now that she's not here, I'm watching Aubrey maybe step a little bit more into things that she might not have done because she would have watched her sister do or enjoyed listening to her sister. So while I know she's missing or terrible, and I don't know that she even knows that she's doing this, but I'm watching her become a little bit more opinionated. You know, hey, Mom, you know, what if we did this instead? That would have never happened before. Okay, whatever you guys want, whatever you guys decide. So she's finding her way as an individual versus the we three. Mm-hmm. And in some ways, that's really, really beautiful. It's bittersweet, but it's beautiful because it's going to make her, like, such a much stronger independent. But she still calls me all the time, which, again, I'm not sure she does that for me or if she's humoring me to parent her. I don't know. But she's a beautiful, beautiful soul.
Wow. That's incredible. I mean, I love hearing you talk about your daughters because, you know, I know every parent loves their daughters, but you just really have this amazing connection with both of them, even though, you know, Sid has passed away. You still have a connection with her, you know, that you just keep so alive and so present. And the same thing with Aubrey. I mean, she just sounds, both of your daughters sound amazing. So I love hearing you talk about them.
Well, thanks. Anytime you want to hear about them, just let me know.
Oh, yeah,
no problem.
I definitely will. It's amazing. Whenever I talk to you, I feel like time goes so fast, and we're already at the end of our time here. So again, I want to mention your book, which is The Voice of an Angel, A Mother's Guide to Grief and How to Thrive After the Loss of a Child. And your website is marcystone.com. So if you guys want to find out more information, you can head right to that website. I mean, there's some really great stuff on there. So I definitely recommend going to the website. And Marcy, I want to thank you for coming on the show today. As always, it's always so great to talk to you.
Thanks for having me again. I've enjoyed our time.
Yes, me as well. And I look forward to the next one. And I hope you enjoy the rest of the day.
Thanks. Take care. You as well.
Thanks. Take care.
Bye. No other love, Mama, I'm flying. No other love, Mama, I'm flying. I can go there.